Welcome back, lads and ladettes, to episode 39. This is the Tobias Enstrom episode.
Yeah, just like a casual episode. Nothing like too crazy, too out of the ordinary. Good show player, consistent.
Dude, honestly, if injuries hadn't ruined his career, like, that guy was kind of a stud back in the day.
Enstrom, man. I'm looking at his, like, elite prospects and stuff right now. What a guy. Atlanta Thrashers to the Jets. And I think right now he's playing pro hockey in... Yeah, he is. Still? Playing pro hockey in Sweden.
How old is he, man? He's got to be in his, like, mid-40s.
He's 35.
That's okay.
Not too bad.
Yeah, he's still, getting up there in age. Yeah,
he's playing for moto hockey again. That's where he started his career. So
that comes full circle.
It really does.
That's really beautiful to see.
Yeah. Enstrom.
Tobias Enstrom. What a player, man. Like, I love going on hockey TV and just, like, researching the most absurd, like, people and stats. And, like, some of them just have no idea.
Rabbit hole.
Yeah, dude. Like, I had no idea Sergei Zubov had 78 assists one year.
Really? Wow.
Yeah.
Sergei Zubov.
Yeah, dude.
What a name. There's some really good, like, hockey names that you can look through when you go through those lists. And you just start finding, like, all these people with crazy names that played professional sports. It's so funny.
Like, I know there's a few good ones. There's like Rusty Cunts was one of them. That's there's just like some iconic sports names.
What's the one guy? He's with like the IIHF. Dick Pound, is that his name?
Oh, I think so.
Or is it with the Olympic Committee?
Yeah, I think Dick Pound is with the Olympic Committee.
Just some great names. Like, it's kind of tough, but I don't know.
Nothing's tougher than the sunburn I'm battling right now, though.
Yeah, man.
So
you sat down and like in every episode, you've kind of almost blended into the wall behind you a little bit. And now you are contrasting that wall harder than I've ever seen.
Good. Because I went up to Waterloo this weekend and hung out with like my orientation team.
Right.
And just got up to no good. And I, at one point, like my friends got who I'll talk a little bit about her later, but we had like an inflatable pool.
Okay.
And we literally just like had these like floaties set up in there.
Yeah.
And then we were just sitting down on the inflatables and like I fell asleep in the sun.
No.
I fought the sun and I lost.
So did you have sunscreen on when you were sitting there or no?
Dude, and I put like a light layer on like my legs.
Yeah.
Dude, my thighs are brutal. Like, so I was laying down with my hands above my head.
Oh, no.
And just like that, just basking. And now I have like a sunburn on my armpit.
So you were basically like starfished.
Yeah, dude. I was literally just sprawling out, relaxing. And
man, that is horrible. You got an armpit sunburn?
I have an armpit sunburn.
How much pain is that? Like,
seriously. It's the worst because like the insides of my arms are always rubbing again. Like, it sucks.
You're going to go play golf today, right? So
yeah, dude. It's a hectic weekend. It's a hectic weekend.
Okay, so for anybody who's watching on YouTube, you can see right now Ryan has... a decent, I don't even know. It's like a good base layer of burn, not even tan. It's just a burn. So McGee, can you stand up really quick? And I will narrate what's happening as you do this. But for the people who are watching on YouTube, you'll be able to clearly see exactly what is going on. And this burn
it's bad.
It is bad. So McGee, stand up here and I'll give it a description. So McGee is pumping himself up, getting ready to do this, clearly in pain. He's like, oh my God. Okay. The burn on this guy's stomach is bright tomato red. And as he is turning, oh my, the tan line is ridiculous. It is so white compared to the red stomach he's got going on. And then the best part of all of this is that McGee has no tan on his back.
Dude, it's like a previous
episode when we talked about those tan lines. We talked about like how you get the Neapolitan ice cream, like half and half. Burn.
It's like a 90-degree angle going up the side of my body and then cutting across to my pants line.
And that's exactly what you've got right now, and it's so aggressive.
It's really bad. But my tan will be arriving in 7 to 10 business days. So I will be a nice golden brown in no time.
You know, like, we really need somebody to invent something that, like there's sunscreens and stuff, obviously, and then they come out with different versions where it's like less oily or less thick or whatever. Like the mist ones are my go-to because I don't like having like the lathered on sunscreen, you know what I'm talking about. They need to invent something that's like you just put it on, it's like Axe body spray but for sunscreen, and it's just not sticky
at all. They have the spray sunscreen, but it's,
I know, but
not,
it's still like, oily, you know what I mean?
It is oily, yeah,
right?
I mean
stuff on, yeah, and then you go in the water and it's like, but
dude, what better person to invent a new product and make it succeed than our next guest, entrepreneur Aaron Spivak. Joining us now is Aaron Spivak. Aaron's a serial entrepreneur who co-founded Revitasize at only 18 years old. Within 4 years, he managed to grow to 8 locations across the GTA. Aaron most recently co-founded a sleep improvement company called Hush Blankets, which was featured on season 14 of Dragon's Den, and which has since grown into an 8-figure brand. Welcome to the show, Aaron. Glad to have you on, man.
Thank you guys so much for having me.
Thanks for joining us. So, Aaron, we want to start right away with your like background in being an entrepreneur. You, at the age of 17, 18, we know very well there's a lot of distractions going around in terms of your social life and next steps in school. And you particularly, you were going into junior hockey. You're playing junior hockey at the time. What would you say was your inspiration to start being an entrepreneur? How did you know that like that was what you wanted to do and that was the path you wanted to follow?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think it was always entrepreneurial when I was very young. I was that guy, cleaning windows with his friends, knocking on doors, trying to start a window cleaning business. We, paved driveways. We, in grade six, I used to sell hats that my mom used to knit. In grade eight, I started a party bus company where we would service all the proms with the buses, pre-prom, prom, after prom, and actually that carried on for quite a few years all the way until high school and even post high school. I got to a point where we were running probably over 50% of all the proms in the city. At one year, I think we had over 180 or 190 different proms, and pretty much had a fleet of buses. So I think the common trend amongst it all is that I always found an issue that was constant, and I always thought to myself, like, why is no one doing this? And then I just said, well, if no one else is going to do it, I'm going to do it. And then, for the prom specifically, it was the parents and the teachers and the principal's fear of drinking on the bus. It was like, the last thing that any principal would want is for a bus to roll up to prom and everyone just be absolutely hammered when they walk in. And, underage drinking is very scary for a lot of principals. So I knew that was a huge issue. And also like how unorganized and sketchy the current bus companies were. Like, you call this man a number on Google and this guy answers from like his cell phone in the car. And he's like, what do you want? Like, no one ever knew if the bus was actually going to show up or not, Like, yeah. Is that my bus? Like, please show up. Like, you've already paid him. And like, you get the dad's credit card. And he's like, what's this? Just the whole experience was awful. So I figured, if I can just cut that out and just like, guarantee people that it'll show up, convince principals to recommend us simply because, we'll prevent them from drinking on the bus kind of thing. And, we found a sweet spot. Everyone was happy with it. I think at one point we threw some DJs and, my friends, we had some dancers on the bus and stuff. We made it fun, but, I was always just trying to service a need. And then, one thing led to the next and, I just kind of continued to scratch that itch.
Yeah, man, that's pretty incredible. I mean, around that age too, like I can only imagine a lot of your buddies are just sitting on their asses playing video games and kind of trying to pull you in the opposite direction. Did you ever feel kind of a sense of pressure? Or like, did anyone give you a hard time kind of preventing you from kind of doing your shit along the way?
Probably. I'm pretty hard headed, so not too much gets me, but I mean, I've been blessed with a small and concise group of friends. I was never a guy who had never had like 20 best friends or something like that. It's always just one or two guys, and we share a lot of this very similar outlooks on life, and we have very similar goals, and it's been like that for a long time. So I don't really, you know, I find in bigger groups, you kind of try to, you become a crowd pleaser. You don't want to piss off this guy or that girl or this group, and kind of just want to hang around. And, you know, there's, I mean, if you go way back to like my podcast from like 3 years ago, I used to use this line. I used to say, gas your shitty friends. And I kind of changed that a bit, but the idea behind that line was that, you know, there's a lot of friends that want you to do good and they want you to do well and succeed, but as long as it's not better than them. And they're tough to find and they're tough to seek out. And they're usually right beside you. Sometimes it's better just to have enemies around you, much safer. So it's, I've been blessed with that. So I never had, I mean, when I was playing hockey, there's obviously guys in your team that are just like that. And that's normal. I mean, you don't expect much different than that, but I was always very clear with keeping people around me that I knew were sharing similar mindsets, and not doesn't necessarily have to be business, but we're still very goal oriented.
Right. So you mentioned there you played hockey along the way, and we touched on it a little bit earlier that you ended up playing junior hockey, and I know you played at York University, but you were actually also the captain of the Markham Royals Junior A hockey team. Would you be able to talk a little bit about like how you managed to balance school, running your businesses, playing junior hockey, like playing hockey at a high level? And also, would you say that playing hockey throughout the way had any kind of influence on your business or the way you thought in terms of going into business and things like that?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, hockey teaches a ton. If you play at a significant level and for a long period of time, you learn things that otherwise at that age you'll never learn. You know, it's I see it with people who haven't played competitive team sports, who haven't, you know, been a 16, 17 year old in a group with 20, 21 year olds. You see it all the time. The way you learn to face adversity, the way you learn to sometimes play a lesser role, the way you learn that your ego doesn't matter in some situations. A lot of that. Hockey teaches a ton of lessons, and I mean, I carry a lot of those till today. It gives you a little bit of toughness, which in business is extremely important, because at hockey, you're at war pretty much every time you step on the ice, but you're not on the ice 24 hours a day. You're on the ice maybe an hour or two at most. In business, you're at war 24 hours a day, where you're up against yourself, you're up against your competitors, you're up against the market, you're up against anything that can come your way. In fact, today we had one of our employees broke a wall and like you couldn't even get into the whole section of the warehouse. Like anything can possibly happen. So it's, hockey's played a huge role, and it still does. It's definitely played a huge role, and I see it most in others who haven't played or haven't been a part of team sports. And it's super cool to see.
Yeah, I can, like, Philly and I both played, Philly played AAA. I played junior for a couple of years, and even growing up, like, as young as grades 4, 5, 6, like, I always felt like a little bit older than my classmates in a way. Like, you kind of just, I don't know, just being involved in that team sport and having that atmosphere, kind of bunch of personalities clashing. I definitely see what you mean there.
16 to 21 is it's a big deal. And it's,
yeah, sure.
It's not a joke.
No, man. So after your hockey, I know you started at Ryerson and saw that you would transfer for York. I guess we just wanted to know what your reasoning was behind that transfer and whether you think that it kind of had anything to do with your success or how the two differed from each other.
Yeah, I mean, I was at Ryerson originally because I was just taking courses while I was playing, and it was the most convenient. And I got accepted to Ryerson out of high school, and then just one of those things where I just stayed there and didn't really care too much. I was just taking courses to stay engaged. And then I transferred to York because I wanted to play hockey there, and it was closer to home. And I had to, you know, my business was like 1.5 kilometers away from school, so it was super convenient. But yeah, that was kind of the reasoning behind that. It was mostly to play hockey. And it was my first full year of school playing hockey and running a business, which was quite nuts, to be honest. But definitely forced me to realize what was more, you know, what was most important for me. So without that year, maybe I wouldn't have, I would have been slower to make decisions that were right for me.
You ended up starting the company Hush Blankets. And for anybody who hasn't seen, you went on Dragon's Den and pitched to the Dragons. You had a partner when you went on, and you still have the partner. Would you mind sharing a little bit about the background of the company Hush Blankets and about how you and your partner Lior first linked up?
Yeah, I mean, we both have very similar entrepreneurial journeys, some differences, but a lot the same. We both started very young. I think he started when he was 19 or 18. We're both dropouts from York. You know, he never did the sport route, but he started his business around that time. I had a business at the time. We connected through mutual friends. And yeah, we were just friends. We had a lot in common. When you start business young, you know, a lot of my friends or people that I knew were in university. So like, what do we have to talk about? I had maybe two friends. He was one of them. Still probably have two friends, but we were friends together, and he's a way more technical founder than I am. So he's in the software business, and I was always so interested in what he was doing online because I was in retail. And then a few years into our friendship in 2017, we connected over this Kickstarter we saw, where there was opportunity to improve a product that was out there, that there was obviously significant demand. And, you know, we both had full-time businesses at the time, and, you know, we were like, listen, we can probably build this thing from 7 p.m. till 2 a.m. every night. And I lived at Young and Dundas, and he lived at Young and Lakeshore, so I was like, I'll just go down the street, and I'll come to your place, because he had a nicer place than I did. And I'm like, we'll buy a bigger desk, and I'll just like post on my laptop after I'm finished work. Like, we'll have a dinner at like 5:36, and then we'll just get. It was just something where I said that he was the Ferrari and I was the engine, because it's like no one in the right mind would want to do that. Like, if you have something good going for you, why would you want to just give away every single night to something that may or may not work out? We just kind of started the train, and we just kept going, and we never really thought it would turn into what it did. But it was quite cool to see that, you know, transpire. You know, so many people talk about like doing more at night, but it was constantly doing that for a year that really showed results, which is quite cool.
Yeah, that's awesome. I know on the pitch, you were saying that your numbers were 600,000, and then they ended up being 3.2 million. Philly and I were kind of discussing that before you got on, and we just wanted to know what you think, or if you think there was kind of a driving force between that huge increase.
Yeah, I mean, a little bit of our story. I mean, we in 2018, when we launched, we knew we didn't want to drop ship. I mean, no offense to any drop shippers that may listen to this, but we weren't interested in the short term money. And a lot of people, they start businesses because, well, for a million reasons. Sometimes to prove people wrong, maybe to show your parents that you're smart enough, or maybe to make some quick money, right? Or whatever it is. And oftentimes the motive behind the reason you start is oftentimes the reason why you fail. So for us, we were extremely clear from the very beginning, where we said that we were going to build something that is going to change the way people sleep. And if it's not going to change the way that people sleep, then we're going to just wrap it up. And we were just clear cut right from the beginning. So in 2018, when we launched, in order to not drop ship, you need to carry inventory. And, you know, we have quite an expensive product, and we sell it for a lot because we pay a lot for it. So we had to sink, you know, our last 3 years of savings from our businesses into this idea. And we both did that, sunk everything we had into it. And, you know, when you do that, things start to change a little bit internally. And then we said, you know what, I don't want to wait 2 months for this product to arrive. Let's just throw it up on pre-order, see if we can sell one. And then we threw it up in, I think, January 20th. And January 28th, 2018, we made our first sale, which was great. We threw, like, we went out of a Google ad and we're like, holy shit, we had a huge celebration. We were popping champagne in this place. We ordered, like, salmon. We spent more money on the meal than we made in the sale, but, like, whatever. And, yeah, it was awesome. And then the next day we made another sale and we're like, holy shit. And like, I'm on the site, like I'm on the chat. Any person that like abandoned the cart, I'm calling them at like 10 o'clock at night saying, why did you abandon the cart? And they're like, if you call my wife again, I'm coming to your house. Like, people were just furious, you know, but I'm trying to figure out like why, you know? And I was just like, you know, the next day was one and then we had a day with zero. And then one day we had three. And then that was when we're like, holy shit, we have a business. And looking back, like three is nothing, but like, you know, you got to celebrate your small wins. So,
yeah.
And it just snowballed from there. And by the time our first container arrived, it sold out. Wasn't that big. It was like a 700 piece container, but it sold out. And then the next container arrived in May and it sold out again. And then June hit and we were on a high, right? We know we thought we're geniuses. And then, you know, June hits and I think we were averaging like six sales a day, seven sales a day. And June hits, we make zero. And then like every 4 days we'd make one sale. And we were like, holy shit, like what happened? Our business sucks. Like what a scam. Let's just focus on our other businesses. Why are we even doing this? And I was like, no, man, we can't do that. Like, we got to figure out why. So I emailed every single person that ever bought. It wasn't that many, maybe like 1,000 people. And I said, why would you not buy this product right now? And everyone's response, those who responded at least, they always said that it was too warm for the summer. Just like, we don't want it. It's like 30 degrees outside. You're giving me a 7-layer blanket, like yeah. Way too warm. And we're like, holy shit, we need a cooling option. We need to come up with a cooling weighted blanket. Didn't exist, never quite existed. And then, you know, one thing led to another. We started sourcing fabrics. I had to learn how to about weaves and overlay and all this weird stuff. And then we landed on a fabric that some guy sent us by accident, and it was like the coolest fabric I've ever felt in my life. And I was like, holy shit, we need this fabric. And then I found a mill to produce it, but they wanted a minimum order of like, it would have been equal to like, I think 10,000 blankets. It was basically $500,000, and we don't have $500,000. I couldn't produce this blanket, but you know, there's one place you can bring an idea, and if they like it, they'll buy it before you have to buy the inventory, and that's Kickstarter. So, and during Q4, which was our first Q4, we realized that there's obviously demand, so we made a little bit of money Q4, and we sunk it all into this idea that, you know, we can come up with this iced product, which we named it, and bring it to the masses, and that people would support us and back us on Kickstarter.
Right.
And then 2019 March, we launched on Kickstarter, and it ended up closing out 30 days. I think closed out 1.5 million, which was the 10th. Yeah, it was the 10th most raised in 30 days in Canadian history.
Wow.
Which is quite special. And that was, you know, to answer your question, how do we hit that big jump? What was that thing? And that really was it. That kickstarted that kickstarted our journey and our business. And you know, it gives you 10,000 customers worldwide. It broke us into the US. It gave us a reason to go on Dragons Den. It really propelled us, you know. So we right. sunk everything into that idea too, and it worked out.
Well, that's pretty cool. So then at that point, what makes you decide you want to go on Dragon's Den? And then further from that, what was like the process of applying and then getting accepted and then ending up on the show? Could you take us through that?
Yeah, I was just on my Instagram one day and I follow one of the dragons, Michelle Romano, and she just like posted a swipe up to auditions. And I thought it was hilarious. I'm like, dude, we got to go on. So I sent it to Leora. I'm like, this would be so funny if your mom is just like watching this at home and like your face comes up. And he's like, man, she loves this show. And I'm like, okay, so let's just apply. And I swipe up. I apply from my phone. I didn't think anything of it. And then like a month or two later, they send us a sheet and they're like, these are the places you can audition. And we know very well that Toronto is going to be packed. You know, they have 3 days in Toronto because they know the volume of them. They have all these other cities, and we're like, we got to go to like the closest place to Toronto that's not Toronto, because even people within that region are still going to travel to Toronto because they believe that Toronto is better. Right. And we went to, I think, Kitchener or Waterloo. We were one of two people auditioning, and we show up, and the other guy, I feel bad, but the other guy was just, he was trying to create a ladder that can't fall, but it kept falling. So, you know, and we were watching him for like an hour, and the producer's like, okay, like, Sarah, like, we got to wrap this up. And he's like, no, I promise it won't fall. He's an older guy, and the poor guy kept falling and actually like landing on the floor. And I'm like, I can't watch this. And then she's like, this is way too risky. So she cut him, and then we show up, and we're like, we have a product that stands. So, you know, we made up our pitch in the car on the way there. We get there, we look at her, we're holding the blanket, we're like, we're here. We didn't even know what we were asking for. She looks at us, she goes, let me just feel this thing. We're like, all right, we put the blanket on her, she was super happy. And then we told her about our give back program, which we thought, you know, something where we donate 1 to 10 blankets. We've done that forever, but we never cared. We never really like spoke about it because it was just something that we did. It wasn't a big deal for us. We didn't want the PR or anything. And she goes, like, you guys do any charitable stuff? And we're like, yeah, we have this give back program. And then her eyes just like lit up, and she's like, wow, this is amazing. And right. We're like, really? And we didn't actually think anyone cared. So yeah, she passed us on to the next phase. And the next phase was the den. You just like show up at this CBC headquarters. You're in this like warehouse looking thing, and you know, you stand outside, and they mic you up, and you're one of like maybe 40 people, 50 people for the day. You have no idea when you're gonna get called. You're just sitting there. I'm like just talking to myself, like practicing scenarios. You know, I'm like shouting shit at Lior. He's shouting stuff back at me. And then, we were just about to go on. She goes, okay, guys, like you're up next. And we're like, sick, ready to go. I'm like, you know, I'm punching the air and stuff. And right before we go on, she goes, actually, you guys aren't going on today. And we're like, what happened? And one of the cameramen who like floats like on like that like thing, he fell and hit his head and cracked his head open. Right before he's supposed to go on, she's like, "Come on,
ladder guy."
yeah, the ladder guy. You know, maybe he was using his thing, right? But he cracks his head, and we're like, "Oh my god, we're gonna go tomorrow." And looking back, we're so happy because we would have been the last person to audition that day. And like, you know, you don't want tired dragons. Like we were tired. The whole thing might have sucked. But we went the next morning at 9 a.m. So like fresh, everyone had their coffee. Like I was wired. Like you can see on the den, like my eyes are coming out of my face. Like I am ready to go. You know, I'm like 17 express. Like I was just ready to go. And like I was doing push-ups in the lobby and stuff. So like when we hit the den, like our energy was just through the roof. And then like they matched it, and it just turned out to be a really cool episode. And I think, it was the first time in history where an evaluation increased on the show. I mean, I don't want to ruin it for those who haven't watched it, but if you watch it, you'll see it's,
highly recommend. If we'll definitely share a clip or something for our Instagram page, but it's one of the most impressive episodes I've seen. Mm-hmm. Like incredible. We actually rewatched it before having you on. It was nuts. It was nuts. I think it was the first time.
It was wild.
There was like the most offers, or I don't know if they knew for sure, but it was like the most offers they thought that they'd had ever. It was all six dragons.
It was 6 for 6, and then an increase in evaluation, which was absolutely never happened. Usually the opposite happens.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
It was super cool.
So whose ideas were the onesies for your pitch?
It was actually Lior, the guy. I was going to wear a t-shirt that said Hush with it with some black pants. And he goes, yeah. I knew he had something up his sleeve. And then the morning of, he goes, I got this thing for us. And I'm like, oh my God. And he rips open this onesie. And I'm like, these are amazing. So we did a pitch, a live Dragon's Den pitch for charity in Montreal. And we wore the same thing. And it was like the funniest thing of all time. So
that's awesome. It's like Peter LaFleur and Dodgeball breaking out the new news.
With the pump, right? But it was hilarious. I still have it somewhere in my closet, that one.
So obviously, like, the energy you said, like you said, was going through the roof as you guys walked in there. Everybody was fresh and ready to go. There's one thing I want to ask. You notice when you watch the video, you guys come in with the onesies, and one of the dragons looks at you guys, sees the onesies, and says, "Oh, onesies, oh God." So,
yeah. Oh boy.
Yeah, oh boy, that's what it was.
Is that a onesie?
Yes. Hello, dragons.
Wow, jeez.
My name.
So as you walked in, like, was it overwhelming walking in and looking at them like that? And then when they say that, did it, like, add on to it, or did it change anything? Too focused and ready.
It was, yeah. It was, that's a good question. I knew every single thing about every single one of them walking in. I know their lines. I know who they like to team up with. I know who they like to make fun of. We knew every single thing. I knew what Arlene likes for breakfast. I know when she has her coffee. So, like, we were so ready that there was nothing they could have said to us that we didn't have an answer for.
Right.
And when we walked in, I mean, listen, we spoke for almost an hour. It's a 6 or 7 minute episode, right? So there's a lot they don't show. But when we actually walked in, I start my pitch, and one of them said, Jim said, he goes, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, hold up. I don't have my pen." And I'm like, "Are you kidding me?" Like, I'm in the middle of my thing, right? And I was like, "Okay, what?" And I said something like, I don't know if it was this pen, but he was not ready for it. And I was like, "Do I keep going?" And I just, like, restarted my pitch. And then we got to the point where we put the blankets on them, and then they all pretend to sleep.
Yeah.
And in the episode, it's like 5 seconds. Maybe in real life it was 2 minutes of them just sleeping.
Oh, so,
and I'm talking, I'm like trying to finish my pitch because I'm gonna forget it because I'm all lapped up, and I'm like, I look at Lior and I'm like, what do I do? And he's just like, keep going. I'm like, all right.
Oh wow, you're gonna wrap us in a blanket.
You guys are gonna get
weighted blankets.
Oh my God, this is heavy.
Yeah.
All right.
Good night, Alice.
So we found a lot of problems with the competitors' blankets.
Can I suck my thumb too?
This is so nice.
They're made of toxic poly pellets. They're not stitched the same way. They don't have the zipper tech technology, which allows you to just simply unzip it and throw it in the wash. So we definitely improved the standard product.
Oh, who's snoring over there? Who's snoring?
Everyone's sleeping.
Jim? Money.
Wow. Dragons, wake up.
Wake up. We gotta make a deal.
Oh,
and I'm pitching them while they're all, and then one of them started snoring. So I was like, oh my God. I was like, this can't be real. And then they, like, obviously woke back up. But then after, like, the initial pitch part, it was super fun. I mean, they got in the beds, they tested the product. They asked a ton of questions,
right,
that were not shown. They were talking about, like, EBITDAs and some detailed stuff. Some of them were talking about, like, CPAs, our customer acquisition strategies. And they were asking quite a lot of stuff, which we were happy they did. But I knew in my head, like, a lot of these questions, I'm like, they're not showing this. The average Canadian isn't right. informed on this type of stuff. And they don't care about this kind of stuff. So, yeah, it was quite good. I mean, right, I think after the first, like, 2 minutes, everyone's guard is down. And, like, we have a normal conversation. It's quite awesome. Right.
So that's, like, them falling asleep. You got to think that's part of their strategy to see how you're going to, I guess, react to some type of adversity. But was there a point in the interview where you felt like, okay, like, we got this. I'm confident in my pitch. I'm pretty sure that someone's going to put an offer out.
Yeah, I mean, here's all the marbles. Hope you have your followers will like this one. But we organized the fact that, like, we organized our response. We knew going in, you know, what evaluations were. We knew that the Dragons want a good deal. We knew that it needed to be affordable. And we knew what our numbers were. So we came in at an evaluation that was really low compared to what our numbers were. So, in fact, half of what we were technically worth.
Right.
So we knew if we came in with something, you just couldn't miss. Like, you just, even if you didn't care, you were not going to give up on that, because, you know, our numbers suggested that they'd make their money back in 12 months, which is unheard of. And we manufactured that. We knew that we wanted to get that response. We didn't want to, you know, you guys are too, you know, all those typical dragons, then you're too expensive, you're out of your mind, you don't know what you're talking about. We didn't want that. We wanted, A, to show people that we've got a quality brand and a quality product, because we knew we weren't talking to the dragons, we were talking to 30 million Canadians. We knew that we wanted to show that we were solid guys and that we were trustworthy, and because if we're trustworthy, our product is trustworthy. And then we knew that if we can come in and give a deal that no one can refuse, then no one will refuse it. So it went almost exactly to plan. We didn't expect the whole evaluation change and all six to come in board, but we knew that we were going to get a deal, because it wasn't something you'd pass up on if you had the money to.
I wanted to ask, because you obviously were very well prepared to go into there with that. Did you kind of expect that your pitch was going to be an hour long, or like, obviously you had done your research on the people and the questions they would ask and the things they would, their statements and whatnot. Did you kind of think it was going to be hurried, or were you under the impression that you were going to have time to discuss with them and answer and ask questions and whatnot?
We knew it was a possibility. Because we were, I mean, the whole first day, we were basically watching people go in and come out, go in and come out.
Right.
So some people were there for like an hour and some people were there for 10 minutes.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, our biggest objective, our only goal of the entire saga, you can call it, from swiping up on a link to actually standing on the den was, we need to get on air, because from the 3,000 applicants, only 300 pitch the dragons. And from the 300 that pitched the dragon, I think around 100 only air. So we had a 1 in 3 chance of actually airing. So right. For us, we knew we needed to be entertaining. We knew we needed to have a really good episode. And which is why it worked out that we came back the next morning, because we were amped up, you know, like,
yeah.
So, and it was like, you know, when people say, oh, you had a great episode, it's like, we didn't actually say anything that was that great, but I feel like people feel our energy, and the dragons matched it. They had the energy too. It was quite awesome.
Yeah, can definitely attest to that. It's an incredible episode, and for any listeners out there who haven't had the opportunity to watch it, highly recommend. I guess you guys definitely won't be disappointed. Mm-hmm. So far in your career, it seems to me that from what you've told me that you kind of had that kind of independent, driven mentality from the beginning. But have you had any role models or supporters through your career? And if so, what's the kind of the best or most useful piece of advice that you've personally received?
Oh man, I've had so many. I had so many and have so many mentors in so many different ways. I've been fortunate actually to have one of my cousins who is 20 years. Yeah. Should be about 20 years older than me. Be a mentor for me. When we were starting Revitasize out of my parents' house, just coaching me through things and being able to watch, mostly the watching, to be honest, being able to watch how he conducted himself in certain situations. And I've been a Gary Vee guy since like 2012. Met him too. I mean, I'm a huge like personal development guy. I'm always looking to level up. I'm challenging myself pretty much every single day. I hate reading, so I read. You know, like I, you know, I'm training to climb Everest. I'm always trying to, you know, I suck at Excel, so I'm taking Excel courses. Like I'm always trying to reach new heights, but. Yeah, I mean, my mentors have really been quite a lot of people. I mean, for my mental health, I have a guy named Adam Klasner, who's done a ton of work with me personally on my personal development. You know, what goes on in my head, because you know it's so cool once you look back and look forward to see that so much of what goes on in your head is what draws your reality. And, you know, a lot of people just don't deal with things. They push things aside. And I was one of them. I mean, hockey kind of unfortunately teaches you to just put your emotions to the side and just get back to work, no matter what the circumstances are. And sometimes that's okay, but most of the times it's not. You got to actually deal with them. And I never dealt with them. I was just like, fuck it, keep working. So, you know, I just worked through any issue I had, but it's cool. So yeah, I've got guys in every category. I mean, I've got my friends who challenge me, you know, I've got, my brothers who challenge me. So I always have, I'm always picking people's brains. I'll probably call one of them at least once a day and say, you know, what's up? What did you learn this week? what could I steal from your brain? And I try to give it back. But yeah, I mean, I learned really early that no matter who you're speaking to, whether you think they're important or not, or whether you think they know things you don't, have knowledge of something that you don't, and it can be anything. And they have experience that you don't. You know, my little brother has experience that I don't. And once you realize that, you start actually paying attention to people. When you pay attention to people, they'll share and you'll learn. And you know, I didn't finish 4 years of school or a master's, but I learned from some of the biggest people in my industry simply by hitting them up and saying, hey, I need 10 minutes. So it's done a lot for me, for sure.
Oh, that's pretty cool. You touched on something.
Yeah. Chills, man.
You touched on something there that we actually didn't know about, and I wanted to ask you about it now. You said you're training to climb Everest. When did you decide to do that, and why?
Yeah, well, I'm actually doing a challenge that is arguably more difficult than climbing Everest. I'm climbing a mountain in Utah. I think it's like 2 miles up, 3 miles up, and I'm doing up, and I'm climbing the equivalent. So Everest is 29,029 feet.
Okay.
That's Everest. I'm climbing 29,029 feet, basically going up and down a mountain. So going up, and it's so long up, it's a 20-minute gondola down, and I'm doing that 13 times, and I can have to do it in 30 hours.
Wow.
So I'm climbing Everest in 30 hours. So no sleep, basically. I'm basically climbing 24 hours straight. And the reason I do it is because, one, I'm a hockey player, so we do sprints. I hate endurance. So I started running 10Ks. I hate running. Like anything I absolutely despise, I just do it, you know, because I want to break it. I want to get through it, right? So, my cousin, who's 20 years older than me, he's very similar to me in terms of how much he's trying to level up. Like, he's sending me meditation things in the morning. I'm sending him books. Like, we're just going back and forth. And we follow a guy named Jesse Itzler. You may or may not know him. If you don't, you got to check him out. He's a part of that super couple. He's married to Sarah Blakely on Spakes, and he's sold, you know, Marquee Jet when he was 26. He did Zico, that coconut water. He owns that. He owns the Atlanta Hawks.
Yeah.
Both individually billionaires, and they're incredible people. And it's his run, but he does like crazy shit. He lives life to the fullest, and he's quite inspiring. And when I launched my Kickstarter, I DM'd him and I said, "Hey, like, we smashed our goal in 45 minutes. Let me know what you think." And he responded, and he's like, "I don't think anything until you hit $1 million or something like that, or don't tell me you hit $1 million." So that was our real goal. And then I hit $1 million and I messaged him and I said, we hit $1 million. And he's like, cool, now, like, what's next? And I was like, wow, you're so right. Like, what is next? And and I've just kind of maintained some dialogue with him. And then, he runs this is his run, his climb. And my cousin's a big fan of him too. And every year we watched on his Instagram, we're like, why don't we go? Why don't we go? And we just said, fuck it. Let's just rip it.
That's pretty cool.
And then, man, always trying to challenge.
So is it like an organized event then, or is it you just go and do it? Like,
no, it's crazy. It's like, you go there and then he speaks, he has a whole seminar thing. And then there's endurance athletes from all over the world that come as trainers. And I think it's only like 150 people, and you have tents, you have like this, you have a nutrition thing. It's extreme, and it's only a 60% success rate. Wow. of actually, like, I mean, some people actually book hotels in the area for after the event because they already know they're not gonna be able to do it. So they want to be able to stay and like finish it at some point. But yeah, we're going to destroy it. So that's our mentality. We're going to just muck it. Might do like 20. I don't know. We'll figure it out. We're going to get it done. That's for sure. It should be fun. I mean, I'll document it on my Insta. See how, if I have the energy, so we started training, we've been training for 2 months, but this month we really started climbing because finally the weather's here and, it's super difficult. Yeah.
That's really wild.
Yeah.
We're kind of going to wrap up shortly, but I got a couple more questions for you here. I guess I know in my business program, I met Laurier and they had a very heavily entrepreneurial based first year. But I know the majority of the students there want to get into finance and do kind of go that route. But for all those aspiring entrepreneurs out there, do you have any advice that kind of helped you? And if so, what would be like the one piece of advice you'd give to anyone listening who kind of wants to follow in similar footsteps as you?
You got to be crazy. And you gotta be nuts. You gotta be nuts, and you need to have an unwavering belief that that you're gonna figure it out. And you gotta do it for the right reasons. I tell people all the time. It's like, I think the one skill that I have outside of like actual skills is when people watch. Me or even my partner or my businesses, they think it's easy. I have this weird thing of just making things look easy. Or when I describe stories, it seems like it all just came together.
Must be nice.
Because yeah, you know, from the outside in, it's like, oh, this guy's life is super easy. And maybe because I don't share any of like the hardships or difficult stuff, I only share the good stuff like most people. But I don't share the losses. I only share the wins. It's normal. So on the outside looking in, it's so easy, but it's not. It's not. It's lonely as nuts. Entrepreneurship is extremely lonely. It's so hard to win at even. It's so hard to even get small wins, and you have to be a specific type of individual. And I mean. I have a lot of friends who jump into the entrepreneurial space because they want to make more money, and that's fine. And it doesn't last because, you know, being an entrepreneur is a marathon, and it's definitely not a sprint. And, you know, there's no safety net. Like there is in finance or in business. Or in just being a, you know, an exec or an employee or whatever you wanted to do, there's a lot more security in that, and it's safer. And if you get a job, you have a boss to say, hey, what do you want me to do? And you have targets and KPIs and key performance indicators. You know what it is, but you have all these things set forth by someone else, and all you got to do is work. And like, not saying it's easy because it's not. I have employees that give them the hardest time ever, but it's way easier than not knowing what to do. Right. You know what I mean? It's way easier than having something happen and have no one to like look up to and say, hey, what do I do now?
Right.
And that's entrepreneurship. You know, it's just, you know, we have 8 locations for Revita. COVID hit, 2 of them closed. The rest are down, you know, a significant amount. And I had no one to go left or right to and say, now what? You know? And like, even if I got fired, government just throws me a check. I'm safe. I'm good. I've got EI. I've got 6 to 8 weeks. I've got experience. Someone else will hire me. As an entrepreneur, you don't have that. It's just, what am I going to do now? Right. You know? So you've got to be like, I remember when I dropped out. Everyone, like, I think I had 2 people that actually said it was a good idea. Everyone gave me the same spiel. You should finish school because what happens if business crashes? What happens if you don't make what you think you're going to make? What happens if it doesn't work out in a few years? You need a backup plan. Everyone, you need, like, school is your backup plan. And that was what everyone said to me. Everyone. And even my cousin is a mentor. He's like, gotta go to school, right? So, and I don't know if I am insane, but I don't know if it was my insanity that came through where I was just like, guys, straight up, if I actually like just like everything, you know, goes down the drain and I'm like, I have no money and I'm just like fucking suck and I'm 30, I don't know, like the worst thing that can possibly happen, I guess. And like, I'll just go to Walmart and I'll beg them to hire me and I'll work for whatever the minimum wage is for a year and I'll save up minimum wage is what, 14, so 28,000. I'll go to my parents' basement. I'll spend 8,000 bucks on food and life and I'll save that 20K and I'll start something else because I have an unwavering belief that in my own ability, whether it's fake or real, I believe it's real. And that's my backup plan. I am my own backup plan. And that was like, and then every time I said that, you know, everyone's face is the same. It was like, yeah, whatever, you know, like, I don't believe it. And that reaction, which I'm sure you guys know, because everyone's, if you've had any idea, I'm sure you've had a lot of in your face, right? And that has nothing to do with you. Right? And it took me a lot of personal development to know that a lot of that reaction that I got from everyone, including your own family. I mean, your family always does it first, but the reaction I got from the reason why I got it had nothing to do with me. It was all to do with them. You know, most people don't believe in themselves, so why would they believe that you can believe in yourself? Doesn't make sense. And it takes time to understand that. It takes time when, you know, people say, hey, you know, Ryan, Zach, your podcast sucks. It, you know, it has nothing to do with you or your podcast. You know, it has everything to do with them, you know, but it's hard. It might be hard for you, or, I mean, you guys have each other to kind of, you know, if one guy gets down, you guys can lean on each other as a benefit of, you know, being together. But it takes a lot to realize that that's just their shit.
Right.
And, you know, I remember, you know, even being on Dragon's Den, we had negativity, even doing our Kickstarter. It's, oh, well, Kickstarters aren't profitable. Even, you know, getting a warehouse, it's like, oh, what happens if it's empty? Even growing more staff is what happens if they underperform. Like, there'll always be something to say. And I think if you're an entrepreneur and you're just, like, if you can't take someone coming up to your face and saying, hey, you're the ugliest person I've ever seen in my life. And if that bothers you, you're not ready for entrepreneurship. Because you're going to get way worse. You're going to get way worse in this game. And I do not preach that one is better than the other. I just preach to do whatever the hell like gets you up in the morning, gets you excited. And if it's, you know, happiness over everything, if you're still on a I mean, I don't know your specific demographic, but I'm assuming potentially university students, give or take a couple years, up or down. If you still want to impress your parents, you're not ready yet. You know, you got to really just get so hard nose. I mean, I'm sure you guys know when you started your podcast, you know, everyone's like, oh, no one's going to listen to your podcast, you know? Yeah. And now you're getting hundreds and maybe thousands of listens, you know? And it's like, you personally don't think you're there yet, but some of those haters, it's like,
right,
you know? Now what?
You have the no pressure, no diamonds artwork behind you. That's basically goes hand in hand with exactly what you're saying.
Yeah. Actually, I got another one. Where is it?
Oh. And we got the YouTube channel coming in hot too. So
I got that.
Got the visuals.
Shoot your shot.
Yeah, shoot your shot. Got the diamonds. This is actually a gift from somebody. And this was, I don't know where the hell that came from. But yeah, man. It's that's entrepreneurship. I just drives me nuts because I feel like. And I'm babbling on about this topic, but
this is super informative. This is awesome.
When I started, how old am I now? 25. I said six, 7 years ago, like legit my first incorporation. It wasn't cool. Like entrepreneurship wasn't cool. Like it was what the dropouts do. It's like if you're not smart enough, then you just start a car dealership or something, you know, like go do a hot dog stand outside the ACC. Like that was like your life. But like now it's like, you know, I've done, you know, these stuff at these schools and it's like all of a sudden it's cool. Like you know, I remember I was at Schulich, and everyone's like, I got all these business ideas. And I'm like, you guys are at Schulich. Like, what the hell do you guys want business ideas for? Like, you're about to go into like a sweet job. Just like focus on your shit. Like, this isn't cool. You know? So I feel like it's becoming a trend now. And I think it's going to leave a lot of people, unfortunately, sad, because people hop on trends for the wrong reasons. So definitely take a deep look at why you want to do whatever that is, what you want to do.
Well, Aaron, I don't think we can thank you enough for coming on and sharing your journey with us and taking us through literally right from the beginning to where you are now and giving us all this insight and honestly the advice you've given and the things you've talked about and how what you focused on and how you got to where you are. It's been incredible to listen to and just sit here and be a part of. I'm so excited for what the listeners are going to be.
I know, man. This has been a treat.
Yeah, to like, sit here and talk.
You've kind of given me, you've given us a new perspective. I mean, you said a lot of things that I kind of like, I'm just like nodding along, like, although I'm just trying to like take it all in. And like, I know like I'm kind of asking the questions here, but I was like, oh my God, like these are incredible answers. Like,
yeah.
Trying to apply these into my everyday life now. Like,
that's I can awesome, hear the man. Gary Vee coming through.
I just try to say shit that I wish people said to me.
We appreciate it, man. It's super appreciative.
That's it.
Yeah, well, thank you for coming on. Thank you for taking the time to do this. We really appreciate it. And well, if anybody wants to go and check it out, Aaron's companies are Hush Blankets and Revitasize. We will post links to both of those and put up a little link to the Dragon's Den episode that they were featured on.
That's
really good. Yeah. Everybody's got to check that out. And then we know that you're gonna climb the mountain and complete the challenge. So it's not even a question of good luck with that.
Yeah, I'm gonna document. Are you guys on LinkedIn?
Yeah, we are.
I just joined a few months ago. It's a wild platform. I love it. I post a lot of crazy shit on there. But
check it out.
That's good. It's like the Facebook of like everyone. I don't know.
For real, man.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Yeah.
All right. Well, thanks for having me, guys. Awesome. I appreciate it.
Thanks for coming on. Thanks for coming on. Appreciate it. Okay. So what an incredible interview. It's one of those ones, like it doesn't necessarily like fit into just like a sports one or like, or anything like that, but it was really cool to have that connection of how he transformed from playing hockey at a high level. Like, he played junior A hockey. He was the captain of a team. He went and played university hockey at York. He won a championship there. And then he transitioned into the business world and was super successful. So it was kind of cool to be able to hear how he tied those things in and like how competitive he is in the business world and how driven and stuff. And even just thinking about like that, that thing that he's doing where he's going to be climbing, right?
Like, yeah. I think the thing that was most interesting for me is how like he always had that like entrepreneurial mindset from the time he was 13, running that prom bus company. Like, dude, what 13-year-old does that, man?
Yeah, it was insane.
This guy's just in a league of his own, and it was super cool to chat with him. We had a blast listening to him, learned a lot, and like just preached some great, stuff about kind of just like personal development too, and how it's kind of the whole everything you do, affects kind of your mindset, what you're feeling, what you're doing. So that was really neat, man.
Yeah. Okay. So. It was really cool to like get to hear this guy talk about all these different like ideas and stuff that he came up with and all the businesses he was doing. It kind of reminds me actually of, or gets me thinking about something that I want to get into for our first Be Better segment. So I think right now is a good time to head into that.
Woohoo!
Okay, so for our Be Better segment this week, this one was actually brought to me by my parents. They nominated it. I got a text last night from my mom because I was out. And my mom texts me and says, we have a Be Better story for you. And I said, I can't wait. And she goes, you're going to need to delete the Skip the Dishes app though. So I'm thinking, okay, that's kind of interesting. Like, what could have happened here? So let me explain. My parents, they ordered dinner last night. And they ordered through the Skip the Dishes app. The restaurant, I guess on the order that they printed off, they failed to print off one of the menu or one of the meals. So they just didn't make the meal and send it. So it gets to my parent, like our house. My parents open it up. It's missing a meal. They look on the receipt. The receipt is missing the meal, but the Skip the Dishes order has all of the orders that they put in.
Mm-hmm.
So my dad calls and is like, hey, we're missing a meal, whatever. Like, it's not on this order, but it is on the skip the dishes. So the guy goes through the process basically saying, like, do you want a refund? Do you want to get the food? And my dad's like, well, somebody here doesn't have a meal, so obviously we want to get the food. And the restaurant says, okay, no worries. We'll contact skip the dishes and get it sent to you. Well, skip the dishes then calls my dad and says they're not going to deliver it because the meal is too small, or like the order size is too small. So they will only refund it. And my dad's like, well, somebody here literally doesn't have a meal. Like, what do you want me to do about that? And they're like, well, I don't know. We'll just refund it. So they wouldn't go and pick up this order. So to me, and my dad said as well, skip the dishes, be better.
Yeah, skip. That's outrageous, man.
That's a joke.
What are you going to do? Make the person without food order their own meal while everyone else is just like indulging? That's
and then the other thing I was thinking about too is like, how can you have like your meal is just too small, or like the order is too small? Like, I get if you're going to try and order like a box of nuggets and nothing else from McDonald's, or like a drink and then that's it. But you're ordering an entire meal, regardless of if there's other meals or not involved. You're ordering a meal. So how can that be too small?
Yeah,
and then somebody literally is left there without a meal. So skip the dishes, be better. Just be better. Like, deleting the app, never use skip the dishes again. That's a
boycott, joke. Skip the dishes.
Boycott, skip the dishes. Everybody that's listening, boycott, skip the dishes. We'll make an impact.
we're DoorDash people now.
Yeah, we're DoorDash. Yeah, so skip the dishes, be better. That's just a joke.
We're now going to jump into our last segment. I feel like we're on a roll. We got to keep her going.
Yeah.
So what I'm proposing for, you know what? This is going to be a Ladette of the week. We have a Ladette of the
week.
Our
second Ladette of the week.
Our second Ladette of the week goes out to a member of O-Team, Aaron Quinn. Shout out, Aaron. She was extremely hospitable this weekend. She allowed me to crash at her place while we were kind of just like doing our thing in the loo and partying with the rest of the team. So I had my own bed and shelter over my head.
That's perfect.
And yeah, man, it was just a class act altogether. Made me lunch.
Wow.
It was just incredible. Aaron, thank you so much once again. You are the Ladette of the week. Congratulations.
Second Ladette of the week. Keeping it consistent here. We got some diversity. I like it. I like it. Good stuff, McGee. Well, that pretty much, I think, wraps up episode 39, the Tobias Enstrom episode.
Dude, Aaron Spivak was a hell of an interview.
Yeah, so much fun. There was points where I felt like we were watching like a Gary Vee or something.
Yeah, man.
Forgetting that I'm interviewing this guy.
Yeah, I know. I mean, a little pause, just like, oh, wait, I have to ask the question. That's the next follow-up.
Yeah, it was a really cool interview.
It was a sick interview. Hope everyone enjoyed it, and there's more big things where that came from.
There's definitely.
So in order to find out what other big things are coming, tune in next week, same time, same place, same launchers. Cheers, lads and ladettes.
Cheers.